Good afternoon, friends. Now, I know you all are tired, and because it's lunchtime, I don't know whether you had your lunch or not. But this session, we are now going to start interpretation of radiological investigations of orbit, in which we'll be covering in short, in 85 minutes, whatever we can cover, about just for ophthalmologists to understand MRI, CT scan, and orbital ultrasonography. So first, I'm going to cover both topics together, because I'll combine both the topics together. And then Dr. Deepak Bhatt is going to cover about ultrasonography. Deepak sahab, aaiye. Because always whenever we see patient comes with MRI or CT scan imaging of orbit, which definitely we also do need to order those investigations, but when it comes for the time for reading, then it becomes little difficult proposition. And we all know this anatomy, based on this we have to interpret, and various reasons for which the globe and the orbit that we do this. Now the question will come, why should we learn? I'm sure everyone must have faced this situation, and I also used to do that. When a patient comes with MRI or CT of orbit, and because he doesn't know that I don't understand, so he wants to show the film, but I don't know. But then in what happens, that usually we used to take out the film, put it in the view box if there is any, maybe upside down, and if not, then we just try to see against some light and do some drama, finally take out the report and read the last paragraph, last sentence, and then say, ha, yeh dekho, yeh hai. So at least with this, though, that's why, means to make ourselves complete ophthalmologists, we must know that. Means I'm not telling that we have to be as proficient as radiologists, but then we should have a basic understanding. Also, we should understand that ultrasonography, which is going to be discussed in this session, so there it is, because we do it ourselves. And so we are very well versed with it and familiar with it. But MRI CT is not done by us. Only thing, it is done and it is sent to us, or the patient comes with the film, so we have to read the film. But then, just to have understanding, probably I will just, because this is the basic lecture which will just give you insight, because in 45 minutes no one can make anyone expert in reading MRI and CT, but then at least some basic information. And why not radiologists talk? Because I'm sure if the radiologist will talk, no one will understand anything. And ophthalmologist, because I have understood, so that way I'm just trying to, in very simplified manner, you will see in next 40 minutes that it will be absolutely simplified for us, because whatever I have understood, I think anyone can understand from us. And but in ophthalmology, there are four investigations which just comes in black and white. But the terminology used are different, because in MRI, the white area is known as hyperintense area. In CT scan, the same white area is known as hyperdense. In ultrasonography, hyperechogenic, and fluorescein angiography, hyperfluorescent. In MRI basics, it's interesting, because based on the structure of an atom, the nucleus contains proton, which is positive charge, neutron, which is neutral charge, and orbiting around this is the electron, which is negative charge, and they all spin around their own axis. Because of this, there is a generation of the magnetic field. And that magnetic field, because of that nature, now it's a, what happens in body, in MRI, what is utilized is basically hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, carbon in abundance. But hydrogen is in abundance because it is in water, and 70% of the body content is water. So it's in abundance. Also, it has got one very peculiar characteristics about this structure, that it contains the single proton, and because of this, it has got the high, it behaves like a dipole magnet, and it has got the highest magnetic field. But in the tissue, it's arranged in a haphazard manner, so nothing can be made out of it, no signal, and we can't make out, interpret anything. But on MRI machine, what happens when the patient is placed within a strong uniform static magnetic field, then these haphazardly arranged hydrogen atoms are aligned with the main magnetic field. So this is parallel low energy state, and some of them are anti-parallel, which is high energy state. Then during the course of this investigation, radio frequency waves are applied. When the radio frequency waves are applied, then these low energy state level, they absorb energy. And they get, some of them get converted into high energy state. And then these, they are known as in the stage of excitation. Okay. So then when this, when the, that was when the radio frequency waves were applied. When this is turned off, then hydrogen nuclei again return to normal state, giving energy to the environment. So first it absorbed energy, and once the radio frequency waves are turned off, then it starts giving energy to the environment, and this is the stage of relaxation. Now this, so earlier was this stage, when this was applied became this, when this was turned off again it returns back to this, but while in returning back to this position, some of them high energy, they release energy. Okay. Now this, the rate, degree, direction and pattern of resonant energy emission by relaxing protons are localized, quantified and transformed into diagnostic images. That is the basis of MRI. So MR images depend upon proton density and proton relaxation dynamics, which are characteristics of tissue's physical and chemical properties. Then in which environment this hydrogen is, based on that it differs. Also whether this hydrogen is in, because you will see in a moment, the water and fat, same hydrogen in both, hydrogen, fat as well as water, but the characteristics, this relaxing energy characteristics are entirely different. So based on this, this has been extensively studied, that which, what are the characteristics of various tissue while they are relaxing. And this we always know, that when we talk about, someone talks as Tesla, 2 Tesla, 3 Tesla, what does it mean? It means nothing. Only thing that the 1 Tesla, this is the unit of magnet unit, 1 Tesla is equivalent to 16,000 times stronger than the Earth's magnet. So the 0.5, 3 Tesla, then you can imagine how much strong this magnetic field is. And higher the Tesla, better is the resolution. But also, unfortunately, the cost goes exponentially high. That's why everyone doesn't possess high Tesla MRI machines. And recently, I'm sure everyone of you must have read one news from the Mumbai hospital, where some patient was taken inside this machine, in the MRI room, with the oxygen cylinder, and the patient was sucked in with the machine and died ultimately, because this is such a strong magnetic field. So that is just to the explain how strong those magnetic fields are. Now this, whenever you study various, then sections are made, those, what is the thickness of the section and what is the inter-slice difference, based on this the resolution depends. So thinner the tissue, better will be resolution. Thinner the inter-slice difference, distance, probably we will have better idea, but it will take more time and also the cost becomes more. So somewhere compromise has to be made. Now whenever we read a film, so basically that was just basic, and whatever basic I explained to you, probably it's very simple in this manner, and I'm sure everyone you must have understand, but this was not as simple as it is explained, because the person who developed it got Nobel Prize. So when we're reading the film, then there are two types of resolution we talk. One is spatial resolution, which is discrimination between two points, that is spatial resolution, and contrast resolution, which is the relaxing signal difference between two adjoining anatomic structures. So this identify, because of the contrast resolution, we are able to identify the various different tissues, whether it is normal or pathological, that will depend upon the characteristics. Now rate of relaxation, again I am repeating this, rate of relaxation of different tissues are different and are utilized in tissue identification. Now there are certain intrinsic biologic properties and extrinsic parameters which improve the contrast. Now intrinsic properties we cannot change, but we can utilize this intrinsic property in the tissue identification. Now I am sure every one of you, if you have, means anyone has seen MRI film, then they always talk about the radiologist T1 images, T2 weighted images. What is T1, T2? It's nothing but the various phases of relaxing energy. So T2 relaxation is spin to spin, means from the nuclei, it gives energy to the uncharged nuclei. So that is T2 relaxation, and this is a very short period. It just starts few milliseconds to a few hundred milliseconds, that's all. Where it ends, the T1 relaxation starts, means the spin to lattice, means from the nucleus to the environment. It gives energy to the environment. This is a very long period. Where did it end? Few hundred milliseconds. So it starts from few hundred milliseconds to couple of seconds. So it's a long duration. So this is T1 relaxation. So T1 relaxation has got different characteristics and helps in tissue identification. T2 has different characteristics and helps in identification. We'll come in a moment shortly. Now that is which is also the blood vessels, because blood vessels always appear dark on MRI. Why? Because say when the blood cells, which is say one section where the blood vessels and the inside the content of the blood vessels, they get energized. By the time the energies start getting emitted and we start capturing that, the blood vessels, the blood cells or whatever was there, it has moved away from that film, so it's from that plane. So whatever image we get is always no image, so it's dark. That's why blood vessels always appear dark on MRI. Now that was intrinsic properties, but we take advantage of that in identification. The extrinsic factors, that's the some are pulse sequence like fast gradient, echo, which is because these pulse radio frequency waves, different pulse sequences have been studied to improve the contrast. And these things we need not bother, but then these are the certain names which are used with the proprietary name of different machines. The contrast agent also improves certain characteristics and helps in identification. In this, the contrast which is approved is gadolinium, triamine pentacetic acid, which is the absolutely safe contrast. The in orbit, because you will again see in a moment that fat gives very bright signal, very bright, intense signal, hyper intense. So the orbit contains full of fat. So then everything be white, very bright. So all other anatomic structures we cannot identify. But we are not interested in fat. So there are certain techniques where the fat signals are suppressed so that the other structures signal can be identified and we can identify the tissues in a better way. Again, these are the various proprietary names of these techniques. The flare is where the fluid signal from the fluid is suppressed. Especially this is used in the identification of brain, means in the diagnosis of brain, especially in the disseminated sclerosis. And in orbit, because the eye contents are very small, so total body, the resolution is not that good. To improve the orbital content resolution, the external coils are used, so it improves the, so some, but everyone doesn't possess this. So whenever you are ordering this, make sure that the radiologist has got this external coil, which is orbit. Now, you know T1. T1 weighted images are basically for anatomy. It highlights anatomy very nicely. T2 mainly for pathologies. Contrast studies are usually done on T1 weighted images, and T2 weighted images are recognized by bright vitreous signal. I'm sure I'll show you next two slides. Here, this is vitreous. It's absolutely dark, hypo-intense. This one, I'm sure anyone, if you have seen any MRI film, this will be very strikingly evident. So the moment you see this, it means these are T2 weighted images. Even without reading on the film, you can say it is T2 weighted images. So now just remain restricted only to this. T1, T2, okay. Now, next couple of slides I am not going to read, but I'll give you the reference at the end where the various anatomical structures characteristics on T1, T2 will be described. Because if I start reading right now, all of you will lose interest in my talk. So just to maintain the interest, because just I'm giving you a guideline, because in the beginning only I told you that the purpose of this talk to initiate interest in this. Once you develop interest, I'm sure you will go very far. So various structures, like what are the various characteristics, I will not read this, but the reference which I'm going to give you in that is a freely downloadable, so don't worry about it, any cost factor. So you can, now one thing I want to highlight. The cortical bone, not well delineated, as it contains little free water. So it appears always dark, hypo-intense. So what is the implication in the our study? That because of this, any tissue, any lesion where we suspect calcification or fractures, trauma, then MRI is not a good modality. Then what is a good, CT scan is a good modality, because there it's a very bright, means hyper-dense, okay. But this also helps in certain way. Where does it help? In the, say, whenever we have to study the disseminated sclerosis, optic neuritis, we have to study the optic nerve in the optic canal. Now with MRI, because the optic canal is all bone, cortical bone, so everything will be dark, hypo-dense, hypo-intense. So it will not disturb The image is because of the optic nerve which is inside. So we can analyze optic nerve in a much better way with MRI as compared to CT scan, and the reason just now I explained. The bone marrow, intense signal on T1 and gray on T2 because of high fat content. T2 image is not ideal for normal anatomy. They are particularly useful for revealing pathological conditions. Now, just one slide on this. Next, I will just again give you a reference. There is one section which is, see, this is the T1 because the vitreous is hypo. This one is optic nerve, the fat. So, see, such a bright, intense signal, hyper intense signal, is all orbital fat. This is the muscle, extraocular muscles. Now, this one you are seeing, this is the lateral orbital wall, which is cortical, so it's all appearing dark. It's signal void. This is what I explained. Cortical bone looks absolutely hypointense. But the medullar bone, inside the same cortical, same the lateral orbital wall, whereas the medulla oblongata, medulla, now you see this is hyperintense because of the high fat content. Sinuses, no water, only air, absolutely dark, hypointense. Okay. Now, whenever we study this I will elaborate a little more. We always study axial scan, then the coronal scan, and the sagittal scan. Okay. Now, this is the sagittal section. The sagittal section is what? Like this. So, how do you recognize this? One orbit or one eyeball in one frame, and the brain tissue will be on top and behind, because just imagine like this. And also remember, this has got four sides. Anterior, posterior, superior, inferior. So whatever is superior on the film is superior, inferior is inferior, and whatever is on your left side is anterior, on right side is posterior. Very simple. So sagittal section, T1, why sagittal, why T1, and I explained to you the four sides. Now this one is, I'm sure everyone will say this is T2. Why? Because vitreous is hyperintense. Axial will be like this. So just imagine this. So axial, like this. Means in this, both orbit and the eyeball will be in one frame and the brain tissue will be behind. It will have four sides, anterior, posterior, right, left. So whatever is superior on the film is anterior and whatever is inferior is posterior. And whatever is on your left side is the right and whatever is on right side is the left. So this is the right orbit, this is the left orbit. Okay. Now this one is coronal section. Coronal is like this. So coronal, what will happen? The both orbit will be there in one frame or eyeball, and as we move backwards, this is written anterior, means it is the eyeball size is quite big. As you move backwards, this section, the eyeball size and the orbit will start getting reduced. And this is T2, and the brain tissue. Here again, there will be four sides, superior, inferior, right, left. So upper is superior and inferior is inferior. And on whatever is on your left side is the right part, and whatever is right side is the left part. So this is just by convention. Okay. Now, this is mid-level. The eyeball size, the orbit has become a little smaller. It's still going further. Now, eyeball is completely disappeared. What you are seeing here is the... means now, this one is very interesting. This is the optic nerve. And optic nerve and surrounded by hyperintense. Why? Because there are meninges surrounding the optic nerve which contains CSF, so it is fluid. Water is hyperintense. Okay. Now this is, I'm sure everyone can say that. Any PG students here in this? None of the PG, okay, then I will just proceed further. So this is just a small exercise because just to generate more interest. This is the T1 because the vitreous is dark. This section, so this is coronal, okay, and anterior because the eyeball size means orbit and eyeball, and these are the muscles and the fat, means it's a quite large size, so it is anterior. Coronal mid level, T1 again. This is T2, why T2, then axial. Okay, now two pictures I'm going to show you. This is T1 coronal anterior, it is written. Okay, T1 coronal anterior. Now just remember some of the things. I'll show you this back again. But next one, you see the next one. Now tell me, what is the difference? Can anyone make out the difference? Only since I'm concentrating only in the orbit, so remain restricted within the orbit. This one was the previous and this is this one. Yes, fantastic. Fat suppression. So in between, whatever fat was there, that is now it's all gone. So it is fat suppressed. Any more difference? Any other difference? Now, I am just giving you a hint. Look at the muscles. This is the muscle. And, And this is the muscle, right? Here it was hypo-intense. And here it is hyper-intense. Not because the fat is suppressed, so it is relatively looking hyper. It's in absolute term also, this is hyper. So this one is with contrast, because the muscle takes up contrast. And whenever contrast is given, fat is suppressed. So this one is T1 coronal plus contrast, coronal plus contrast with muscle enhancement and fat suppression. So wherever you see the muscle is enhanced, hyper intense, means it is with contrast. Even, although it, these things will be written on the film, but then at least just by looking at the film, you can make out that this is with contrast. Okay, the same going little backwards. You see there's such a high muscle, this much hyper intensity was not there in the usual without contrast. Now this is again axial T1 fat suppression with contrast, because this much muscle hyper intensity is not the normal muscle hyper intensity. Okay, now some more examples. So far some interest is still there, alive or not gone? No. Yes. Then the whenever we order, then also we have to think that we cannot just order blindly. That okay, you get everything done, orbit bhi kara lo, brain bhi kara lo, sab kuch kara lo. Because then the more you order, the more time will it take, and also the cost will go high. So suppose the main pathology we are suspecting orbit, then only order orbit, brain will be just scanned crudely. If it is brain, then only brain, the orbit will be scanned. Whenever you suspect that no, both are equally important for me, then only you order both. Now various indications you can make out any, just the one limitation which I told you about the bone and the soft tissue. But in trauma, if the suspect fractures, then CT scan is a better modality. Otherwise soft tissue injury, the MRI is a better modality. But remember, whenever you are ordering MRI in injury patient, trauma patient, you have to rule out by plain X-ray any ferromagnetic foreign body. Otherwise you will be causing damage to the patient rather than any help to the patient. So these are various indications. Again, all these references, it will be given. Contraindications mainly this. Earlier, the various implants in the body which was used to apply was not MRI compatible. But now most of the implants are MRI compatible. But then whenever it is done, means that's of course the radiologist's job to find out. But that is the contraindication. There's certain contrast, certain implants which are not compatible. And also, sometimes when the patient is say in a foreign body, metallic, then definitely it is contraindicated. And all those patients who are very fat, they cannot go inside the machine. It cannot be done. Someone who is claustrophobic cannot get it done, because for at least any test you do, it half an hour is gone. And it's very tiring, and you have to be there in the dark, lie still for half an hour, is very difficult. And so those things are some contraindication. Now this again, now if you have developed some interest, then I will give you reference in this certain normal anatomical structures at various levels and the various sections. That level diagram, if you study, then you will get a mental picture that okay, now this looks what? This looks, and what does it look on T1? Means, and what is the appearance and what? So those are level diagram. These are all in the that reference which I'll be giving you. So don't get worried. If you develop interest, just at the last slide, I will show you that reference, so you can take a picture of that, and so that you can proceed from there. Because there, if I start telling you one structure, you will have a second structure, third, the moment I move to the third structure, you will lose interest. Okay. So these are all various sections, level diagrams. Again, this is from the freely downloadable book from the net, where the various normal anatomical structures. Okay. Now, just before we proceed further, we come to the basics of a CT scan. Now, CT scan, that was without any radiation, MRI. But CT, based on attenuation of X-ray, tissue with higher atomic numbers and greater electron density will absorb more and attenuate more. There are rotating radiation source, rotating detection array, and data are digitized, analyzed, and provides grayscale image reconstruction based on attenuation coefficient of the image tissues. And but here the terminology used are hyperdense and hypodense. MRI, hyperintense and hypointense. Now the unit of attenuation is known as Hounsfield unit, and it varies in the various tissue, the tissues in the body, from 1,000 minus 1,000, which is air, to plus 3,000, which is bone and metal. Now this is the normal tissue in the various tissue, the normally existing in the orbit, and the Hounsfield unit. Now here one difference you make out, that the water is minus 100, fat is minus 1,000. So on MRI, the fat was hyperintense, hyper. But here it will be dark, minus 1,000, so hypodense. Water again, water also, sorry, this not air was minus 1,000, fat is 100, minus 100. Water is zero. So the, and plus all the other structures, it is except the bone and the metal is over less than 100. So just a narrow window from minus 100, which is fat, if that also, if you leave aside, from zero water to 100, all most of the tissues except bone and metal is over. Now, there, because of this, now I'll just explain a little bit of concept of the bone window and the window width. Now, what happens? The range is from minus 1,000 to, say, plus 1,000. Okay. Now, minus 1,000 at this end, which is hypodense, dark, plus 1,000 at this end, which is white, hyperdense. Now, black and white, how many shades you can create? So, minus 1,000, plus 1,000. Now, from 0 to 100, which is most of the tissues are over, now range is very narrow. So, there will be hardly any difference that you will be, you can make out, and you can identify various tissues in this range. So, because of this, what is done to enhance these identification, that if you create, say, suppose a bone window, you say that, okay, now I'm creating a window where this, the study window, which where I will study only minus 100 to plus 100, so it is a range of 200, minus 100 will be dark, hypodense, plus 100 will be white, hyperdense. Okay, anything which is more than 100 will be all white, hyperdense. So you cannot differentiate anything beyond that. Anything which is less than 100, we cannot differentiate. All will be dark, hypodense. Okay, but from instead of earlier this 100 to minus 100 to plus 100 falling in this range, it has been expanded to this range. So the steps will be more, better identified. So you can, the tissue identification is better. That's why now we also talk of various tissue windows in CT scan. So if it is soft tissue window, probably you can start from 100, go up to 150 or whatever it is. So that is the window width, and the middle level is the window level. So if it is 50, minus 50 to plus 150, so the window width is what? Minus 50 to plus 150, it is 200 Hounsfield unit. And where is the window level? The in-between is where? 75. Correct. Okay. So this is how, I mean, sorry, 25. So this is how we have to, I mean, study that. And why it is done it? It is basically done to highlight and identify the tissue in a better manner. And again, this the various axes, nothing different than MRI. Then the contrast here is used is the IV iodinated contrast, especially the, but in orbit it's not very frequently used and not very frequently required. Now just see this one of the lesion, which is the cutaneous lesion here, means this hemangioma, where this is with contrast, taking of contrast. So just example. So certain tissue identification can be done with help of contrast. Now this is the window width, and so one can be soft tissue window, one can be bone window, one can be brain window, because whichever the area of interest, that way the window can be created for better identification or the sensitivity of tissue identification. I think I am clear about this window width and window level now. Okay. Now this, just example of one picture, which is here what you see. Now the soft tissues are very nicely delineated. Very nicely, all soft tissues you are seeing in the orbit and the eye. But the bone, there is no differentiation you can make out. Anything, slight difference you cannot make out. Everything is white. The same picture, same patient. Now, here the bone characteristics is very nicely delineated. But soft tissue, everything is dark. You can't make out anything. What is muscle? What is lens? Where is orbital coat? Nothing. So this is the bone window. So this is the importance. Whichever is the area of interest, that window can be created and can be studied in a better way. Again, the CT film, patient data, and all these type of sections, the right, left, superior, that I explained, same, holds true here also. And certain technical parameters, slice thickness, scan time, Hounsfield number, window width, window level, all those things I explained. Now, just like MRI, in CT scan also, means the normal anatomic structures first you have to identify. Here nothing like T1 and T2 weighted images. Here it is all either with contrast or without contrast. So now the various, from again I'll give you a reference. In that reference, this various normal anatomic structures, how does it look? These are all axial scans at the lower level because the nasal prominence, as you move up, these nasal prominence starts receding and the various structures in the orbit will be different, so can be identified. Okay, so that level diagram, I'll again give you the reference, same way the coronal section, coronal scan for the CT scan. So how does the coronal section in the various levels of CT scan depict the various anatomic structures? Okay, again, this is the same book which I told you, this reference also I'll give you, so you need not worry right now, because right now basically you have to understand the concept. If you develop interest and develop a concept, you can dwell upon that in future. Okay, now we come to the basic questions. Again, we'll come to some example, because 15 minutes more, okay. The orbital pathologies, because why we are doing it, CT scan or MRI or for that matter, even the ultrasound which will be discussed, why? Because there must be some orbital pathology to find out what is the diagnosis, what is the pathological condition. So we have to approach, how do we approach? So we have to consider four factors, because this is a very systematic manner I'm going to explain to you. So what are those? One is that there are two types of effects from orbital pathologies which can be produced. What are those two? One is the functional effect. Means the functional effect, because suppose there is something and the function of certain nerve is affected or muscle is affected, so that it will be presented in the form of clinical picture, but it will show no abnormality on the MRI or CT or any imaging modality. So the functional effect of any lesion will be based on the clinical picture, or it will give you some clinical picture. The other one is the mass effect. The mass effect, either shifting of structures or enlargement of a space or the pressure, all these things will be again produce some symptoms, and also it can be picked up by the MRI or CT scan. So it means, why I'm telling you this, that whenever you're reading a film, MRI or CT scan, then only on CT film or MRI film, you cannot come to a conclusion. You cannot come to a diagnosis. So you have to also know that what are the clinical pictures. So both you have to correlate together. MRI picture, CT scan picture, and along with that, the clinical picture. Okay, so this is the one factor you have to consider in mind. The second thing that you should know, that any lesion that in the orbit is going to be, what are the three things that you can think of? One is that certain lesions start de novo in the orbital and periorbital tissues. Okay. Then there is maybe certain condition where it is reflection of a systemic disease. Like if there is a lymphoma, lymphoma can arise everywhere in the body, including the orbit, simultaneously. So this is the second possibility. The third possibility, there are tumors somewhere else, and later on the secondaries from that tumor has come to the orbit and got deposited. So you have to also think the second. So first one was, what are the MRI pictures and CT picture and the clinical, the first factor. Second factor, that the patient who is sitting in front of me, so what type of lesion I am dealing with, whether it is just the lesion started in the orbit itself or part of the systemic problem or secondaries. The third factor they have to consider, that any pathologies in the orbit will fall in one of the five categories. So what are these? Whether it's inflammatory, neoplastic, structural abnormality, vascular, or degenerations and depositions. So what I'm dealing with, this is the third factor you have to consider. The fourth one is again important, that where is the, which compartment of the orbit this lesion is situated. That will give you, that you will come to know by how? By MRI and CT images. So there, the various spaces, because all clinical spaces or whatever spaces which have been anatomically described, contains or there is possibility of certain specific lesions in that particular area. So the extraconal space, extraocular muscles, extraconal space, subperiosteal space, lacrimal gland, ocular and presceptal space. Now, this again, some of the slides, I'm scared before showing you that slide because it's a huge list. Now, all space, intraconal, so the next few slides, it will tell you what is the boundary of this space and what are the common lesions occurring there and uncommon lesions occurring there. Again, don't try to read this now, go to the reference later on. So just quickly I will run through, so I am scared. Intraconal space, the boundary, common lesions, uncommon lesions, extraocular muscles, common lesions, uncommon lesions, extraconal means from the muscle and the septum, intermuscular septum to the periosteum. This space, common lesion, uncommon lesion, subperiosteal space, lacrimal gland is not a space, but then the lesions are definitely distinct in the lacrimal gland. And ocular, usually for ocular lesions, usually we hardly do MRI or CT. And preseptal space, again, we never do it unless there is only one reason that suppose if there is some, whether the cellulitis has gone, become posterior, means they cross the septal, the septum or not. So then just to know that whether it has gone, because then the treatment differs. So, but rarely it is required to do that. So that is something again, go to the reference. Now, MRI, some of the examples. Whenever you see a film, then what you have to do? Place the MRI film in the viewing box. What is the abnormality and characteristics of lesion in T1 and T2 weighted images that you try to see? Then what is the location, means compartment of the lesion? I explained you the reason for that and importance. What is the extent of the lesion? What are the morphological characteristics such as well circumscribed, diffuse, mottled, uniform, fluid space, etc. Review a special sequence such as flare, stir if it has been done. Is contrast done? If yes, what is the nature of the lesion post contrast? And correlate clinically as to able to have differential diagnosis. Okay, so now some of the examples I will show you. And because the time is still, because it's not long, so I'll quickly run through these and not interact with the audience. And just one slide, I think I'll interact. Now this here, what we are seeing. Now this one is T1. So what we are seeing on the T1 weighted images, why T1? Because the vitreous is hypo-intense. Now this one is a well-circumscribed, hyper-intense lesion in the intraconal space, because this is the muscle, behind the orbit, intraconal space. On T2, again, well-circumscribed, hyper-intense, little less than the vitreous, but this is well circumscribed. This one is, which is the muscle with contrast, because the muscle is hyper intense. See, the muscle is hyper intense, fat suppressed. So this is taking up contrast. Now with this type of characteristics, probably there is no differential diagnosis also. This is just cavernous hemangioma, fantastic. This is the one which we very commonly come across, the ophthalmologist. And here, what we are seeing that the muscle is, all muscle is, even in this section as well as this section, the muscles are enlarged. And one differentiation which differentiates between the two conditions, which is very common where the muscle is affected, muscle thickness, one is where the thyroid the pathology, thyroid related associated pathology, and other one which is the pseudotumor or myositis. That in thyroid one, the insertion is not affected, only the muscle belly, whereas the insertion is also affected in the pseudotumor or myositis. So this is thyroid-associated orbitopathy. Now this one is something interesting, so I will spend some time. Already arrow mark is given there. Now what we are seeing, this is T1. It is extraocular. This is the lens, so close to the mesenteric part, near the limbus, which is hyper-intense mass, extraocular, and close to the limbus. On T2, this is hypo-intense. This is with the muscle, you see, it is hyper-intense, fat suppressed. So with this, with the contrast and fat suppression, again the mass is hypo-intense. Now what characteristics we are seeing here? Also, if you look simultaneously, the fat content of the orbit, along with this is hyper-intense, this is hyper-intense. Here the fat is gone, this is also gone. Here again the fat is suppressed, this is gone. So what does it indicate? There is something which is close to the limbus, the extraocular, and full of fat content. So with this, I'm sure everyone will say that this is, okay. So this is not interesting. This is not difficult if you start really analyzing it and thinking little logically. So again, I think I must have repeated five times or six times I am repeating that this lecture is only initiate interest. It is not, no one can make, neither I am not expert or nor you can become expert just in this 45 minutes talk. So, but then if I am able to generate interest and develop something which from there you can move forward, I'll be more than happy. Now this one is the next lesion. Means there are many slides, pathological conditions, but I have just chosen only few interesting and the simple ones so that you don't lose interest. And because any lecture, any person, if he starts coming to the, means from the podium, starts talking very hi-fi, I'm sure outside, after going out, the audience starts, basically starts, means probably just thinking, kya samajhta hai apne ko ye? So that I just want to make it very simple so that you don't get that feeling outside later on. Now this one is hyper T1, hyper intense mass, which is intraocular. Now with this, you see the T2, hypo intense. Now this is with the contrast, muscle is hyper intense, fat is gone. So this one is taking up little contrasts. So with this characteristics, it is uveal melanoma. Okay. But means this is only for example purpose has been shown. It's not that for this you will do this, order this MRI. And if you start ordering MRI, the next day patient will start moving away from you and will say, doctor, bahut costly investigation karata hai. So if you can see these lesions, probably there's nothing like it. If you cannot see, then the better option is definitely ultrasonography, which we are going to listen later on with Dr. Deepak Bhatt is going to talk. Now this again is the, if you see the characteristics of the lesion, similar what I showed you in the first one, first pathological condition, the intraconal hyperintense mass, and this is cavernous hemangioma. It takes up contrast with the contrast and fat suppression. This again, same thing. Now this one, I'm sure everyone will come up with diagnosis immediately. What we are seeing here, there is some lesion because already it is marked here. So this is T2, this is T1. So what you are seeing, this hyper intense means T2 vitreous, which is liquid, is hyper, this is also hyper. Now this T1 liquid is hypo. Here also what you are seeing is hypo, and it is basically in the situated in the muscle complex and well circumcised like 6 space. What can it be? And also arrow mark is there. But the arrow mark is there, you can see hyper intensity with that, and with that there cannot be anything else. Okay. So far so good, interesting. I hope I have been able to keep up the interest. Now again, that these are some of the lesions which I showed you with MRI. Now similarly, certain lesions on CT scan, but this again I am not going to, because then I don't want to burden your, tax your brain, especially from the morning you have been listening to very, and some of you might have attended the breakfast course. So since 8 o'clock, if you are here listening something to different halls, so there is a retaining capacity up to a limit, so I don't want to cross that. So just these references I'll give you again at the end, so later on you can go and leisurely study those references and see those pictures and pathological conditions so that it gets fixed up in your mind. Now this one is something which is again very simple, that's why again I stopped here, that what you are seeing here, that orbital tissue, there is a congestion, hyper density, okay. And this is the cavernous sinus. This side is almost straight line. Here it is diffuse, hyper, and the convex border, and it's all, it looks engorged. And the back pressure is also coming into the orbital tissues. Okay. So interesting. Now this picture which you are seeing here, this is, I'm sure no one will say it is intraconal, but actually it is intraconal and cavernous hemangioma. But it's looking as if it's superior over the eyeball. So these are all, now one thing more you are seeing, that here on all those, the bone, you are seeing these all those bones which are hyper dense. In the MRI, you will not see all these orbital wall like this. It's all dark. So various pathological conditions. Now in this intraocular lesion and intraocular lesions, calcification, and the it's very simple. If whenever you see any tissue with calcification, most likely it is that, the retinoblastoma. Now this is what the myositis, because here you see this muscle, means whatever you are seeing, the muscles, that is also the insertion is also the entire, apart from belly, the insertion also is affected. So this is myositis. And this is Graves' ophthalmopathy, thyroid related, where the tendon is not involved. Blowout fracture here, floor fracture, not the orbital rim. Now this is the googly question that can anyone volunteer, or I just proceed because time is almost over. See this. Now this is intraocular mass, T1. This is with contrast, taking up contrast. This is T2. Now why there is something dark over here? And this is the same, but here it is looking entirely different. Everything is dark, but here it is white. So can anyone volunteer why it is so? If someone who has not heard my lecture before. Sorry? Fantastic, why? But why it is looking like this? Sorry? I said, no, it's a googly. Okay. These three are MRI. Calcification, hypo-intense, so signal void. This is CT scan, see the bone, this is CT scan. So this is calcification. So this is basically retinoblastoma. So that's why I said that. So all these three are MRI. This is same patient, same picture on CT scan. So I think I have just missed, at least I emphasized that point very strongly. That what is the difference in the calcific lesion and the bony lesions in the. So advantages probably I will not go through, and so next time when a patient comes with the MRI film, don't do drama. See the film, note the point, compare with the full report, see the discrepancy with the. Then you see the entire report of the patient from the radiologist, and then see what is the final diagnosis and what is the difference that you have missed out. Sometimes radiologist also might have missed something. So this is the way to learn more. And I acknowledge the help taken by these when I was trying to learn this. And all these, this reference I was talking, there are four references given. This one is JCOR. This is also both on MRI basics and MRI pathological conditions. Very simple to read. This is the book which is freely downloadable from the net. And this is the article in IGO on CT scan. So all this, whatever I have said, that if you want to really get those things fixed in your brain, please go through these articles in next 1 month. Otherwise, this lecture will be absolutely useless. And again, probably sometimes you have to attend my lecture again. So thank you very much for your patient listening. So now I move on to Dr. Deepak Bhatt, who is going to talk about the ultrasonography of the eye and the orbit.
Okay. Yes, sir? Good afternoon, everyone. We had heard extensively about the CT scan and MRI. I'll spend a few minutes on ultrasonography. This is a little review. It's not a comprehensive ultrasound talk. And we started off with 10 megahertz probe, and this was the resolution that we had. And then we moved on to, now I use 20 megahertz probe for a lot of conditions. And we have the 50 megahertz for the anterior segment lesions. What have I learned over the surgery period is what I'm going to talk to you right now, and what's the future. Okay, so we start off with the vitreous cavity, right? We have four different types of echoes over here. There are lots of them, but these can easily be differentiated into what conditions we are looking at. Look at this few discrete echoes within the vitreous cavity, which are freely mobile. Okay, don't make a diagnosis of hemorrhage over here. You look at the characteristics. They are freely mobile of the same intensity occupying the entire vitreous cavity. Look at this. These are also few discrete echoes, but they are of a very high intensity. So this is astroid hyalosis, and these are floaters. Both conditions which do not have much clinical, much pathological problem for the patient. As opposed to that, we have again few discrete echoes, but they are of different intensities right here. And here they are bright echoes, more at the posterior pole. This is at the center. This is vitreous hemorrhage. This is inflammation within the eye. So what I want to emphasize here is that vitreous echoes per se does not give you a diagnosis. We have to know what is the clinical condition of the patient, and then add on to what we see into the vitreous cavity. Now, what is the role of ultrasound when we are dealing with inflammation? Is to stage as to what the ultrasound of the inflammation it is, and then probably help the surgeon to decide as to what is to going to do. This is vitreous echoes just within the vitreous cavity with no chorioretinal thickening is vitritis. Okay, when the chorioretinal thickening starts going on, it turns from vitritis to endophthalmitis. And when we start getting fluid into the tenon space is when we go on to panophthalmitis. So that has a different clinical significance. So ultrasound helps in that. Okay. Now, what type of inflammation can we make out on ultrasound? Not all inflammation, but except for posterior scleritis. If there are some students in the room, this is an exam case spot which is seen. You see more thickening of the chorioretinal layer at the posterior pole with fluid in the tenon space and enlargement of the optic nerve called as the T sign or the inverted T sign. Okay. Now we come to our most famous diagnosis, and that is of vitreous hemorrhage. We can grade what is the vitreous hemorrhage. This is just discrete echoes which are mobile. This is early vitreous hemorrhage. Then the hemorrhage gets organized. It looks like a mass over here. At that stage, probably intervention is required. But most important is to know where there are the attachments of the membrane over the optic nerve. As you see here, that's the optic nerve. That's the macula. This is the vitreous membrane which is attached to the macula, lifting up the macula. So we can tell the surgeon that yes, the macula is lifted, and hence the prognosis is poor. So it not only helps us to stage, but it helps us to gauge as to what is the prognosis to the patient. Again, I want to emphasize the point that this is hemorrhage, this is inflammation. Can ultrasound give has any feature which differentiates one from the two? No. It has to be a clinical picture, and then ultrasound adds on to it. Another point that I want to make over here is that when you are dealing with early means in the first 24 hours, anybody has a hemorrhage or inflammation, we will get a normal scan. Why? Because at that stage, the echoes are of the same echogenicity as the vitreous cavity. There is no interfaces, hence no scans. Therefore, we should always scan the vitreous at high gains. Look at this. This is 80. This is 87. Look at the brightness over here. Before we say the vitreous is normal, one should scan the vitreous at the high intensity. Then minimal amount of hemorrhage can be picked up. Now we come to membranes within the vitreous cavity, okay? That's classical RD, and these are all vitreous membranes. So what I want to tell you is a uniform thick membrane attached to the disc is an RD, and irregular thin membrane with after movements is a PVD. There are lots of criteria to differentiate one from the other, but these are the two most important criteria to differentiate an RD from a PVD, right? So a thick uniform membrane, that's an RD, which has no after movements. This is a thin undulating membrane and has after movements. A scan, if you want, one can utilize. The reflectivity of RD is more, the reflectivity of PVD is less. Okay. Now, post-operative RD, retinal detachment condition. These are very tricky to do on an ultrasound, sorry. That is a little bit of vitreous hemorrhage post-vitrectomy. But can you see a membrane which is attached to the optic disc and the scleral buckle? This is a recurrent RD, polling vitrectomy. But many of the times, we do see a small membrane nearly at the posterior pole or the periphery in vitrectomized patient. Do not jump to a conclusion that this is an RD. I've had lots and lots of these people where there is some amount of blood collection in the subretinal space somewhere in the periphery. And if you follow up this patient, this membrane, the fluid gets absorbed and the retina settles down. So making a diagnosis of an RD in a post-vitrectomized eye, one has to be very sure. Look at the thin membrane over here and look at the thick membrane over here. Sorry. Always in a post-vitrectomized case, we see a small little area in the anterior vitreous cavity, which looks like a localized RD or a vitreous traction, but this is called as a vitreous coat, which is a normal thing in a post-vitrectomized patient. And again, if you want to look at vitreous hemorrhage in a post-vitrectomized patient, one should always increase the gains because the vitreous is absent. Just few examples of two clinical cases where they have two different clinical picture, but the ultrasound picture looks very similar. In the case of leukocoria, where there is a membrane attached to the optic disc and at the posterior capsule, these two membranes look the same, but look very carefully. This membrane is very thick at the optic nerve and thin when it goes anterior. This membrane is very thin at the optic nerve and thick as it goes anterior. This is PHPV and this is chronic close funnel RD. So two clinic conditions having a very similar clinical picture, but two ultrasound appearances. Again, you have a patient who has no PL and a completely opaque cornea. It comes to you for an ultrasound. Look at this picture over here. It's a completely opacified vitreous cavity, bright vitreous, a thin little membrane here in the center, okay? And this is also hypoechoic. And look at here, there is completely opacified vitreous, no membranes noted anywhere. This, both pictures would look clinically the same. This is close funnel RD, and this is chronic vitreous hemorrhage. So that can give us two different opacity. Again, a patient who has undergone an operation and has had a bad post-operative period. On the operation table, you feel that everything has come forward. What is it? We are not sure whether there's vitreous hemorrhage or suprachoroidal hemorrhage. Look at these two pictures over here. They look very, very similar. They both are taken on the second day post-op. On this side, it is completely opacified vitreous. There is nothing here in front of the optic disc. But look at this picture. In front of the optic disc, we are seeing a sort of a triangular shaped area, which is clear. There is nothing attached over here. Okay, so this is suprachoroidal, fresh suprachoroidal hemorrhage, and this is dense vitreous hemorrhage. Why do we see this? Because anatomically, the choroid cannot get attached to the optic disc. It has to stop short of the optic disc, so always a clear amount of vitreous will be present over there. So you have a similar clinical picture, but two diagnoses on ultrasound. Okay, now we come to mass lesions. This is fantastic case of retinoblastoma with calcification. But as I said, calcification does not always occur. It occurs in only 50% of retinoblastomas. A scan is very, very helpful. It has an irregular A peak, which helps us to differentiate retinoblastoma for other conditions. Sometimes changing the gains into the on the eye can also help us in cases of retinoblastoma, because retinoblastoma, the calcifications are micro calcifications. They are in the centers, they may not be visible on high gains. So when we change the gains, they become very, very apparent. So one needs to play around with the machine to make the things much, much better. Okay, differential diagnosis of leukocoria. I brought all the cases together. This is a close funnel RD with a lot of subretinal echoes. So this is Coats disease. And that's again a close funnel RD with a lot of echoes in the front of the vitreous cavity. That's ROP. And this is the PHPV that I had shown you earlier. In adults, the choroidal melanoma, we had seen an MRI of that, has a classical picture, a dome shape or a dumbbell shaped tumor with a lot of hypoechoic areas at the base, which is the choroidal excavation. This is one probable tumor, malignant tumor in the human body, which has uniform echogenicity. Okay, it has a uniform echogenicity, even though it is a malignant lesion. And therefore, we have this cascading A scan, which is a very hallmark of a choroidal melanoma. Because as you go through the tumor, the interfaces are less, and therefore we get a cascading reflectivity. As opposed to that, the other choroidal lesions have a different picture. If you are looking at choroidal hemangioma, it again has a very little irregular or a uniform echogenicity like a melanoma, but always on the top of the lesion, you will always get two or three bright spots. Okay, these are phlebolites, and this can be seen when we reduce the gains and can be appreciated well. This is helps us to differentiate a melanoma from a hemangioma. Okay, if you have localized choroidal lesion, elevated lesion like this, there is a differential diagnosis of a choroidal mass versus a localized suprachoroidal hemorrhage. If you look at it very carefully, you are seeing a membrane over here, and the echogenicity inside is extremely irregular. Now, to highlight this membrane well, one again needs to play around with the gains. So the membrane is seen well, the hemorrhage is reduced, and we can appreciate that this is a localized suprachoroidal hemorrhage and not a choroidal tumor. I had a patient like this who was very, very confusing. He was an 85-year-old army man who had the sudden loss of vision in the right eye, and he presented with a lesion something like this. So I saw these two domes, and then therefore I thought that yes, this is probably a metastatic lesion, and that was the optic nerve over here, not very appreciated, and nothing was seen over here. So I thought that this is a metastatic lesion, and he was advised a lot in this age group, a lot of investigation. Now he just ran away. He said, I don't want to do anything. He went to his village, and probably after 6 months or I think 8 months, he just come back and said that my vision looks a little better. Okay, you just do a scan. And this is the scan after 8 months. Can you see here the two domes which were seen here are seen very separately, distinctly. That's the optic nerve, and we started seeing a clear space in front of the optic nerve. There are a lot of echoes here. So he had a spontaneous suprachoroidal hemorrhage with a secondary vitreous hemorrhage in front of the optic nerve, which was giving us a picture something like this. This definitely looks like a mass. But on the follow-up here, this cleared off. And again, we gave an option that we probably drain or something. He again ran away and came after 1.5 years. And you can see that the suprachoroidal hemorrhage has practically got absorbed. There are just thickening over here. And this is the remnant of a vitreous hemorrhage with a thick PVD attached to the optic disc. Okay. So anyway, we could have done anything before. I don't know. Whether we could have helped him before, I don't know. But the point is that all ultrasound pictures may not be very clear. A lot of follow-up is also required. And a suprachoroidal hemorrhage can definitely mimic a choroidal mass lesion. But in a very elderly age group, when you see a choroidal mass lesion, suprachoroidal hemorrhage, spontaneous suprachoroidal hemorrhage should always be a differential diagnosis. Ultrasound in trauma, I need to just emphasize 2 points over here. Trauma is something which has fooled me for so many years and fooled all of us for so many years. There is a different characteristics of all the hemorrhage and detachments that we see on a trauma. So whenever we do an ultrasound of trauma on day one, do not make a diagnosis. When you follow up the patient, the situation in that same patient changes over a period of time. I'll give you this example. These are the two cases of trauma on second or third day when they presented to me. Like this is just a vitreous hemorrhage with a lot of membranes, young guy, with retina looks to be absolutely attached. When we say the retina is attached, the patient disappears for a very long period of time. And when this fellow came to me after 10 days of his trauma, you can see that the hemorrhage is absorbed and you're developing an RD. So he doesn't have an RD on day one does not mean that he's going to have an RD or later on. So a follow-up is important. As opposed to that, look at this picture. When I saw it on the second day, I said that this is hemorrhage, but I could see a thick membrane attached to the disc with a lot of echoes behind it. So I said that this is a retinal detachment with the massive subretinal bleed. So this patient was extremely psyched. Again, he did not have money. He ran away. And then he presented after 15 days of ultrasound. Look at the hemorrhage. It's got totally absorbed. And this is a PVD. It's not an RD, which is attached to the optic disc. The retina is in position. So his picture is probably better. So in cases of trauma, our normal pathological findings do not always follow the dictum. So one needs to follow up these patients. And whenever you plan to do a definitive surgery after 10 days or 15 days or 2 weeks, repeat an ultrasound at that time. That if there was no RD before, an RD could have developed. If there was RD before, that RD could have disappeared because we would have made a misdiagnosis. Intraocular foreign body. Again, this is always going to be tricky. They have an habit of hiding away from the probe and running away in any corner and not being seen on an ultrasound. So always take a plain radiograph. A plain radiograph is important from a medico-legal point of view. And if there is anything, anywhere the foreign body, it will always be seen on a plain radiograph, unless it is a radiolucent foreign body. Radiolucent foreign bodies are extremely rare. Majority of the foreign bodies are radio-opaque. Okay. Now, but you need to do a lot of things with a machine to really find out where the foreign body is. Now, this is a case where you see a very bright echo right at the center. And when you follow up, reduce the gains, you realize that the foreign body is only this small. And these are all reverberation artifacts. This is seen with a glass foreign body. Whereas look at this case over here. I saw a dense hemorrhage, some bright spot over here. There was not much shadowing. That is the optic nerve. So I thought that this is probably no foreign body, only an organized hemorrhage. But when I reduced the gains, I could see the foreign body very distinctly. And all the hemorrhagic echoes have subsided. Okay, and now in the orbit, we need to do the same thing. Again, a case of organized hemorrhage with a bright echo right behind the sclera. We are not sure whether it is the foreign body or not. Again, reduce the gains. All the echoes are subsided. The foreign body is very heavily seen very clearly. Just within the next 3-4 minutes, I will show you how a 20 megahertz probe helps us in the diagnosis of a lot of conditions, especially at the posterior pole. So this is 10 megahertz probe, say 20 megahertz probe, same picture, it looks same, much better. But this is not where it is helpful. It is helpful as two conditions like this, where there is minimal elevation of the retina. I am not sure whether we are dealing with a mass or not. So the same patient, I put it on a 20 megahertz probe. That's this same patient, when you see on a 20 megahertz probe, you can realize that the retina is elevated and there's a clear space behind it. So this is localized subretinal fluid. Nothing needs to be done. Whereas this lesion stays the same. So this is probably a small melanoma or a tumor which needs to be followed up. Optic disc, if one wants to see very clearly, one needs to get a 20 megahertz probe. This is how a normal optic disc is seen. That was a small little drusen year and year. On a 20 megahertz, appreciated very well. On a 10 megahertz, it was not seen very clearly. And if you have early optic disc cupping, that can be seen very well with a 20 megahertz probe. Now, I started using it in the era when the OCT was not there. I'm just comparing you with a few cases where OCT and 20 megahertz probe. Of course, the OCT has much higher resolution than 20 megahertz probe. But if you have an opaque media, what do you do? This is a large PED, which is also seen on a 20 megahertz probe. Cystoid macular edema, one can see the thickening of the macula with few cysts there. Again, a tractional RD, see on a OCT, it is again seen on a 20 megahertz, almost similar picture. That's again a small little traction seen on a 20 megahertz probe. So I call this an opaque media OCT. When you have a vitreous hemorrhage and you don't know what's happening to the macula, is when you use the 20 megahertz probe. This is dense vitreous hemorrhage. This is TRD over the macula, which is seen with 20 megahertz probe, and one can alert the surgeon prior to the surgery. Again, a case of leukocoria in a small child, which presented to me on a 10 megahertz probe. I could see some echoes in the anterior vitreous cavity, but I was not sure. On a 20 megahertz probe, we can see that there is an anterior PHPV, a thin membrane not seen with a 10 megahertz probe. We had a case of cysticercosis in the anterior near the ora serrata, which is not very well seen on a 10 megahertz, but on a 20 megahertz, you could see the cyst very well. Subluxation of the lenses, we can see with the 20 megahertz probe. There is zonular tear with vitreous in the AC. Okay, and the posterior capsule. Now, this is a posterior subcapsular cataract. That is a dense cataract, no break here, but this is a posterior lenticonus seen very well with a 20 megahertz probe. I leave you with the last case. This is a really interesting case which came to me some 3-4 years back. This was a homeopathic couple who, husband and wife, both being homeopath, they came home on a motorcycle and they had some foreign body irritation in the eye. So the wife looked at it with a torch and said that there's some speck over the cornea, probably some dust particle, and I will remove it, no need of going to the ophthalmologist. So she took a 20cc syringe, filled it up with fluid, and said, I'll flush your foreign body out. So see, in front of it, she was trying to flush the out. Unfortunately, the syringe, the needle came out from the syringe and went into his eye directly. Can you see the UBM, a clear tract in the cornea? It obliquely went into the anterior capsule, went through the corneal lens substance, broke the posterior capsule over here, lens matter in the anterior vitreous cavity. He had to undergo a vitrectomy, lensectomy. Fortunately, it stopped over here, the retina was not attached, okay. So in short, if you use a high resolution probe and with a good clinical history and maximum findings can be utilized for clinical diagnosis, do not jump to conclusions, especially in trauma. Follow-up is necessary and good utilization of the machines is a must. Thank you very much. I think we end the session over here. Dr. Nayak has already left. Thank you very much for all being over here in the session.